your work with you guys. With that, our friends from Johannesburg. Thank you.
So, yeah, I don't know how you would describe Johannesburg in relation to L.A., no? No, but for me, you know, coming to L.A. has been a bit of a dream to think, I think that when people were building Johannesburg, they were thinking about L.A. And now if you want to know what's going to happen if maybe we don't change the way we practice, live, you must come to Johannesburg and have a look, because it's a bit like L.A. on speed. Yeah, so I will be talking about the Informal Studio, which is a teaching experiment that was supported by the Goethe Institute of Johannesburg. And it really sought to engage with informal processes of housing, really at a time when the formal processes are revealed to just not work. And in fact, that the formal setup or mindset criminalizes something which could actually contain a solution for us. So, unfortunately, my partner, Anna Grabner, who was instrumental in setting up the studio, could not make it. But I'm very pleased that Tsebogo is here today. And he's a guy we've been working with a lot. Mm-hmm. He was even one of our students at some point. Mm-hmm. And he was actually very successful as a student, and he never listened to us. So, yeah, I don't know if I'm such a great teacher, but he can maybe tell you. So he will speak about his experience in the informal studio and also just the practice he does in teaching and his work as the next generation of architects in South Africa. And really, why he's here and why we're together, is I think we share this really, it's almost like a gut aggression, you know, like a need to see our profession transform and actually transform the spatial legacy of our city, which is so ingrained that it's everywhere. So if you look at this picture, that line really separates the past from the present, and there's no big difference between the two. I work in Johannesburg. It's one of the most unequal cities in the world, where architects are complicit in extending the template laid down during apartheid. This slide shows a state of housing, a state housing project we have been busy with since 2004. I think you even worked on it, huh? Mm-hmm. The line in the middle ground delineates the past from the future. In the background, you can see the typical dormitory town for the black working class built 50 years ago, located on cheap land, far away on the periphery of cities with minimal secondary infrastructure. And in the foreground, you can see what we are building now, during democracy. So the project with Goethe Institute helped us not just get stuck in this kind of reality. So as architects, we became really, really aware of our role in extending this landscape, this unjust landscape. But also, we became aware of waging a kind of war through our profession on people who have built alternative landscapes, alternative cities, with their own hands in the face of the backlog that exists. And so what you see here is housing that's delivered at an absolute fraction of the cost and at a much, much quicker speed. So sure, it's got huge problems, but I think we can't just deny it, and so we also can't romanticize it. No, but it's my job as an architect. You can see this thing is built in the road reserve. It's my job to get rid of it. So we were incredibly fortunate to, we've established a working relationship with the Goethe Institute, and it really helped us to create a small space in which as architects we could just breathe a bit, and think, and not be so under pressure of, you know, life and a project with deadlines and clients with budgets. And so we Right. So we started a course at the on in-situ upgrading, right? And it's kind of a movement that's simmering globally, I think, to say let's acknowledge what people build and see if we can upgrade it into cities. So if you think about that, it's just young cities that are being allowed to grow and establish themselves. So this course sought to work with residents of informal settlements on strategies for incremental improvement of their neighborhoods. For the first course, we were able to secure a partnership with residents and NGOs active in Ramsar, which is a small settlement on the western outskirts of the city. And here we were given a teaching space in the local church, where we worked with inhabitants and students to produce one thing, one drawing. And that was a reblocking map. So you can see this is, we divided the group into four groups and four sectors of the settlement. This is them working on a typical studio day, and sometimes these days also happened at university, on this one drawing. So this drawing shows how a first fix can be undertaken in order to create spaces for roads that will contain future services, to undo overcrowding, to redistribute space more fairly, and to allow for the passage of emergency vehicles, and a whole number of things. And this map was then the map that the community, together with the NGO, used to start changing the settlement. So it's not like a favela that's generally built more solidly. This is built mainly on timber framework with sheeting. And you can literally move a house in half a day. So let's give it a day. But you can also move a fence post in 10 minutes, right? Because it's not like legal property yet. There's no title to the land. And that creates space for the future infrastructure. So if I just show you, if I do this, this was done in 6 months, right? by residents themselves. We assisted here and there. For instance, we were called in when someone had already built a house in brick, and they didn't really feel like moving it out of the future road. Mm-hmm. And they called us in, they said, hey, can you guys just measure here, and can you see if we can keep this guy's house? He's getting really grumpy. And we just got to like make the road go around him, yeah. So what that does is that if you think of the cities as young cities that can be formalized over time, it actually promises for really interesting urbanism that has that first act of settling on a land, the kind of logic of people who figure out where the stormwater is, where the roads are, where the shade is, the big trees. That gets inscribed into the future city. And I think that can be a much more humane city if I look at environments that professionals create for people. So now I'm going to quickly talk about the second project. So we did two projects. And the following year after Ramsar, we were invited to Marlborough South, which is an apartheid buffer created to contain Alexandra, one of Johannesburg's biggest townships. And it's not far away from Sandton, which Tebogo said to me, you've got to show Sandton also, mm-hmm. Which is the richest square mile in Africa, right? So it's a no-brainer that people will want to come and stay close to Sandton with these jobs. So this picture just shows you a figure ground and how that the informal fabric of Alex has started to creep into this industrial buffer which was planned as a industrial estate to contain Alexandra. And over the last 3 decades, people started moving into warehouses and factories because this idea of the industrial estate never really, really took off. So there's whole communities and villages living under the protection of a warehouse, a big roof, sometimes also outside. Some work that the students did. But the key drawing here is just a really big land use map. And on closer inspection, we can see a hybrid urbanism with dwellings, creches, churches, restaurants, informal manufacturing, traders, even schools, existing alongside formal businesses and industries. This map formed one of the key outputs of the 7-week course, demonstrating to the city that their efforts to evict people, and believe it or not, the city is sometimes feels like waging an act of war on its own people, and they want to turn this back into a pure industrial estate. So essentially, that thing I said where you just keep on filling and fleshing out the apartheid template. But this map showed them that they were entirely misguided. And then something really unexpected happened. And people were asking in the last 2 days, how do you connect the grassroots kind of research and activism to the top? This map ended up on our vice president's desk. Okay, what happened with it is another story. But the fact that you did it and you actually revealed a kind of reality that is so rich and shocking in its potential can make those connections. So another outcome of the course was that we did a traveling exhibitions, and it contained models, films, comics, something we called Life Worlds, which you can speak about later if you want to know what it is, remind me. And it has been exhibited locally and abroad to stimulate a new and much more direct imagination of the city. I can't tell you how bored I am of dystopia or utopia. It is really actually doesn't do it for me. I think we need to start thinking about things that we can do right now and that can be done by ordinary people. And really, it's to stimulate a debate where we can combine the opposite poles of informal and formal, what Alex was saying, to make the connections. An urban vision that is more inclusive and tolerant, dynamic and alive, stimulating a form of education and practice where the architect is not necessarily the expert, but steeped in listening and observing, responding and drawing in support of a people-driven process in which these young cities created by hand, by people themselves, can have a future and thrive. So this is just examples of a workshop we did in St. Louis, taking the data that we measured from the informal studio and creating a whole new city that can start and is already starting. Right? It is already starting. All we have to do is not mess with it and try and support it, try and raise awareness around it so that we can actually just see. That's actually what it's about in a big part, I think. So if we go back to, you mentioned the value or the mission we have. So as an architect, my mission is to add value by educating myself, my community, teachers and students, to not be so blindly complicit in continuing to build an unjust city, but to discover and harness the solutions ordinary people have developed to survive in this place and to develop a set of values that guide us. These are very basic. They're really easily understood and they inform everything we do in order to pursue that vision. So just very simply, it's to suspend judgment. That's the first one. No, it's the thing I learned in first year. It's like no good or bad. Recognize the extraordinary, because life is truly stranger than fiction. You cannot come up with the stuff you will encounter if you look. To make design work hard, I think any design decision has to do a multiple number of things. Mm-hmm. To create moments. Moments like this, I think, really important, but also moments, I was speaking to Anna about what she's passionate about where people can sit in between the private and the public and just be, and also to connect people. So I think that is one of the key things, is that the world is just too complicated for one profession, one silo to understand. And the reality, the lived reality, someone said yesterday, is waiting for the day when lived reality, lived experience is actually credentialized and acknowledged, and that when you do work like this, that the people you work with are legitimate, equal experts. Yeah. So with this, I'm going to hand over to Toboho. Mm-hmm. Thank you. Okay. From me for now.
Okay. thank you, Thorsten, for offering me the privilege, and Goethe Institute and SciArc for invited me to come present. So my journey actually started at this moment where I was sketching the informal settlement, the studio that Thorsten was a lead architect and lecturer, and then it was more about understanding what defines an informal settlement. And for me, I kind of saw like the complex spaces that are created within a settlement, especially looking at the edge about it becomes a servitude for pipes, and it becomes a courtyard, it becomes a social space, it becomes a threshold to enter and exit, and it also becomes a social space. So with this rich analysis, then I started to change my perception towards architecture to actually look at this as actually this is where I should be learning from. And then from now on, every architecture should suspend the judgment that I'm the one who knows more, and actually the community is designing for itself. It's just that to us, it's an informal process that we haven't yet to understand. So with that process, I worked heavily with Thorsten, and we ran the 495 workshop city, where we're looking at medium rise, high density dwellings, where we're creating this 1:20 big models, and then the aim is to actually flesh out the opportunities and the socio-economic platforms that could be created and coupled with housing. And these models were built in 3 hours. And that was fantastic to see how students with professionals and the public, how they can actually engage together to create this harmonious street in a short space of time. And everything, it's based on people's lived experiences and the stories that they know about individuals in the city. And that workshop, because it was so fun, we ran it as well in Sao Paulo, on Occupy Housing Workshop with Escola da Cidade. And it was looking at a high-rise, high-density dwelling, Raupai, one of the most dense buildings in Sao Paulo. And what's interesting is that the students envisioned this alley in between the building, which has a similar characteristics to the Ponte Tower in Johannesburg, where people just dump rubbish on it. And then if you actually clean it up, it becomes this very dynamic space for kids and the public to engage. And when you create characters of the buildings, then the spaces transform. So Johannesburg has went through a big transition, and this is one of the suburbs in Johannesburg close to the CBD. It is called Fetus. It is a suburb that allowed for mixed races to dwell without any conflict. And then during the Group Areas Act, the apartheid government demolished the houses and removed the people of color to the far, far edges of the city as a means of oppression and also gaining power over the city, because this suburb was sandwiched between two cemeteries, so it can't grow bigger than this. So it was easy to create that transition. And this is what it looks and feels like at the moment. So people are still trying to regain that economy that was lost back in the days, but the history is there. The people, everyone, they got lost. They become marginalized. So I took the first year students there and then asked them, like, what project would they like to initiate within the space? And then the students talked about, actually, they need to look into the past to try and look into the future. So we invited this author, Yusuf, who wrote books on the tales of Fetus, and the students were more interested in the concept of time. So we just hung a watch up there to talk about this is a continuous architecture will always manifest itself through time, and in that time we can look into the past and look into the future. And then when that man sat there, he was touched by the sort of sensitivity that the students came with about acknowledging that what the lost the architecture that was demolished by the apartheid government is something that actually would have fueled a positive urbanism in Johannesburg, that also would have stopped the migration of the upper class moving from the CBD and just leaving it abandoned, and then creating a new city just next to it, which is Rosebank and Sandton. So there was a disturbed sort of urbanism and process that could have actually became successful for the building of our city. So we do have situations where there's a lot of homeless kids in Johannesburg, and it's mostly the youth who are homeless. So as a lecturer, I was working with a postgrad student, and then we asked them to design towers for housing. And then this particular student came with a fantastic concept about changing the notion of homelessness by reversing it. that homeless kids normally have to be eligible for adoption. Then she said we need to change the narrative that students actually, the homeless kids need to create their own city. So she rendered this building as this platform where the children can render scenarios on policies, homelessness, and what does it mean to have a functional family structure. So within this tower, the kids become the pioneers. They run the building. They decide on policies. They will decide if they want to be adopted or not. But that is something that is shied upon because it always creates this anxiety that the only time you are part of society is when you're in a proper family structure. So we remove that mindset. And it provides this platform that can also be translated through a comic. And then the student was very creative with this project. And it was more like creating something that can be accessible as a comic book. And this is the vision for that tower, that it's relatable to the kids, for the kids, run by them. And in certain spaces, only kids can access them. Adults can access them because of head height. So it changes, the space changes according to the different stages of a child's life. And this is a project that I was heavily participating in. The Migrant City was also part of my master's project, which looks at the migrancy of women with children in Johannesburg, because it also relates to the transition from one city to another city, and then the accessibility to state services, as in housing, healthcare, and shelter. So with this project, I looked at a refugee center in Bertrams, and it offers migrant women with children refuge for about 0 to 6 months or a year, depending on the woman's situation and case. And I immediately looked at what are the news. South Africa, especially Johannesburg, we've been having tense conflicts regarding migrants and refugees, where there's been like conflict. And also the city's officials are also the reason why we also have the tension as well, because they still don't know how to deal with this subject matter. And most of the women and children are marginalized. They are on the edges, they're on the traffic roads, waiting, begging, looking for refuge. So it's difficult to find asylum status in South Africa, because of this, just so many migrants flowing into the space. And the aim is that you want a better dream. You want to have a better life for your children. So I changed the narrative for myself by, with an architectural discourse, to also start becoming using art as activism for the architectural language to change. So I built a series of installations, sculptures, that I plugged into the city to raise their awareness, and also they become coded maps as to where, as a woman with child, to find refuge. So the aim is like casting concrete and change the surface patterns of the city. And then the aim is that they can be colonized by plants, and it becomes an installation to look at. And I also built a series of models that become props and sets for the stop frame animation that I'm going to show you next. And then I made a very short movie on that subject matter. So I have to go escape. Is that full screen?
government has dismissed claims by Joburg Mayor Herman Mashaba that it's dragging its feet in supporting his initiatives to address challenges of undocumented migrants. Government says it's a national issue and that the number of undocumented migrants is lower than documented ones. Mashaba discussed the issue with the Nigerian Consular General Godwin Adama today.
For some reason, it looks like the Minister of Home Affairs wants to punch this country into chaos. Abdicating his responsibility to ensure that we have the rule of law. But we will hold them accountable on behalf of you, on behalf of our foreign visitors.
The list of violent attacks on foreign nationals has affected the relations between South Africa and some of its northern neighbors.
That's it for me too. Thank you.